Math, assuming 500 review files so far, that's 10 to be found between 10 and 25 errors, which gives you an error rate of about 4%. Doesn't sound that bad, right? With more than 100,000 foreclosures still on deck, however, you can figure, I don't know, at least 4,500 homeowners could currently be getting a raw deal, thrown out of their house, their kids taken out of school, all this nonsense. It's a mistake, though. You know, it's not that big of a deal. Bank of America could, of course, resume foreclosures as early as this week, despite finding those mistakes. They call them minor. Again, try to explain that to the 4,500 homeowners who are now getting evicted or the millions of taxpayers who are being stolen from by these very same bankers by injecting their bad loans into our government as they have been for years and, of course, covering it up with money printing and avoiding any sort of an investigation. It's working lovely for them. And while the lenders make their so-called mistakes, Washington makes believe we don't have a problem in a way to try to keep their jobs. We'll see if it works. Joining us now, someone who actually does get it on this issue, Lisa Epstein, has been described as a foreclosure nurse. Jumpstart the firestorm over this controversy through her blogging, foreclosurehamlet.org. Lisa, you call for these fraud closure docs weapons of mass destruction. What do you mean?
Well, I mean that the mortgage-backed securities, I think they omitted the mortgage-backed part, so they have created these securities. They use the average American family as victims to bomb. They managed to take every cent from the American citizens, whether it's through a fraudulent mortgage, a fraudulent origination, whether it's lying to the pension funds or 401k investors, whether it's packaging it up and getting insurance because it was a bunch of junk to begin with, and then we bail out AIG, whether it's our jobs and our economy, whether it's grading us on credit scores that they have decimated. And then they went out into the world and actually spread this plague, this scourge. Mortgage-backed securities is the wrong way. MBS, there's no mortgages backing these securities. They didn't put them in. I think we should call these malicious bankers with syphilis. And they've infected the world. I'm a nurse. I'll take a syringe with penicillin. We need to take our medicine. It's going to hurt. But these bankers with syphilis need to be taken out.
Are you surprised years on into this? And by the way, if you're free at 4 o'clock some afternoon, I may want to take a couple of days off, and you seem to have a good handle on the situation. We'll be in touch. But if you were to look at the government's failure to respond, failure to investigate, effort to cover it up, the language from our own president, the TARP lie from our own president, Tim Geithner, with one lie after another when it comes to the TARP, how much longer do you actually think the federal government can get away with either lying or covering this up before it really blows up in all the politicians' face? Because quite honestly, at this point, I feel like there are more and more people who know what you and I know, and fewer pretending it's not true.
Right. Well, you ask an excellent question. I believe we are at a critical juncture. It's amazing that we are just a few weeks away from an election and not a word from many, many candidates. Alan Grayson is a notable example. What I believe will happen as our country goes through the next couple months is one of two things. We will decide to prop up this this fake economy that the bankers say their balance books. I don't know how many banks are claiming the same mortgage over and over. It's fakery. It's fraud. We'll either prop it up and it will fall in 10 years after we have taught our citizenry don't trust the government. The judiciary holds no area of recourse for you. Protect your own. There will be
vigilantes.
People protecting themselves. Vigilantes. I'm so sorry. It's a little nerve-wracking.
It's fine. You're doing great.
There will be vigilantes across America just defending the home that they have their children in. And because there are predators coming in to take the property of Americans. So in 10 years, it will be a much dangerous time for this to fall apart as opposed to just let's take our medicine now. We have dark days ahead. We have allowed perpetrators and predators that are abusive and dangerous to take over and infiltrate the very fabric of America. They violated our constitutional rights. and we need to wrest whatever we have left of, the American Democratic Republic out of the hands of these criminals.
Yeah, Bill Black joins us. Bill, you've been listening to Lisa Epstein, who runs a blog, again, foreclosurehamlet.org, also works as a registered nurse, and above everything else, I think, really captures the soul of the awakening American. Lisa, all too familiar with the structure of American finance and how riddled with fraud it is and how self-serving it is to both the politicians and executives in charge. What can be done at this point by someone in my position, in Lisa's position, or any other position to prevent 10 more years of pretending and fraud so that we end up in the total dismantling of the social contract in this country and intervene now when there may be still an opportunity to both audit the fraud and begin some sort of restructuring?
Well, you can continue to do just what Lisa and you and folks like us have been doing because it's starting to work. Last week, for the very first time, a Nobel Prize winner, Joe Stiglitz, said, "This crisis is all about fraud." Now, Krugman still can't quite bring himself to use the F word very often, but empirically, we know that Lisa isn't simply the soul. Her analytics are correct in most places, and Geithner's analytics are disastrously wrong in most places. So here are some numbers. Credit Suisse says that by 2006, 49% of all mortgage originations in the United States were liar's loans. The lowest incidence of fraud when we study liar's loans is 50%, and that's when the fraudsters study themselves. When independent folks study it, it's in the 80 to 90% fraud range. That means there were millions of acts of fraud. Those loan frauds occur not because there's some clever person making $20,000 a year who is able to deceive the banks, but because the banks created incentive structures for the loan brokers to bring them the absolute worst of the worst loans and to lie on the application forms to hit the magic ratios on loan to value and things like that that a homeowner wouldn't have even known what number to put in. So these frauds came from the banks, and they propagated through the system through a series of what we call echo epidemics, in which they got appraisers first to give them grossly inflated values, and there are excellent numbers on that, to give outside auditors to give them clean opinions on ludicrous financial statements. Every single time they were able to get a clean opinion, and every single time virtually they were able to get a AAA rating out of the credit rating agency. So this fraud did in fact spread through the system, and that's why we have a crisis in foreclosures now. This is not a random, unrelated fraud. This stems from the underlying fraud by the lenders in mortgage loans to the tune of more than well over a million cases a year by 2005.
So then if we were to look at the two ends of the spectrum that most affect Americans, the homeowner, which we've been discussing and will continue to discuss as the critical intersection, and then what I would argue the secondary intersection is all of the taxpayers who are being asked to support this corrupt and fraudulent banking system through Fannie Mae, Freddie Mac, the Federal Reserve, and direct expenditures authorized by our own Congress. In addition to what we're doing on foreclosure, Professor Black, what can we do to amplify the demand to see what percentage of the paper that was given to the guts of the American taxpayer in 2008 by George Bush and Hank Paulson, and then perpetuated by Barack Obama and Tim Geithner, what percentage of that is indeed fraudulent, and why don't we know that 2 years later?
That's exactly what we've been calling for, and why didn't we know it at least 5 years ago when most of this was done? So Bernanke has just announced they're going to do an intensive review of the assets they accepted as collateral. So you wait a year and a half and then you look at your collateral? Now, what would happen if you were the most junior VP at a small savings and loan, if that's what your approach to business would be? This is supposed to be the most sophisticated guy in the world. And so what should we do now? We should look, and we should look on a scientific basis. We have the ability, because of Fannie and Freddie, the Federal Home Loan Banks and the Federal Reserve taking all this money in collateral to do a superb sampling job that'll tell us exactly what happened in mortgages. That what has to be done. It cannot be done by the Fed because it's in a complete conflict of interest. The Fed cannot admit that it took over $1.5 billion in toxic garbage and didn't recognize the losses on it. So it's led the cover up. It's the Fed, through Bernanke deliberately, working with the Chamber of Commerce and the American Bankers Association, who got Congress to extort the Financial Accounting Standard Board to pervert the accounting rules so that they wouldn't have to recognize the losses. Because they don't have to recognize the losses, they report fictional income and massive bonuses, and they gut the prompt corrective action law. All of those things need to change. We call for bringing in the FDIC, which is the best of the worst, and the GAO to look. But have you had a chance to look at Borofsky's report today?
Yes, I have. I have, unfortunately, had that opportunity, yes.
Yes, exactly. Wherever we look, we find massive fraud. And look now, Fannie and Freddie have started to look. The Federal Reserve Bank of New York have started to look. BlackRock, PIMCO have looked. And one of the major monolines looked, said that 97%, this is AMBAC, said that 97% of the loans that Countrywide provided to it were sold under false reps and warranties.
And listen, I'm going to wrap this up just on the basis of time, but you do really have to really start to wonder how much longer this president or any president can get, or any political party can get away with the turn the page and we'll just move on and be friends concept of economic policy when the fraud is at the core of the system.
No convictions.
Yeah.
Dylan, no convictions versus over 1,000 in the savings and loan debacle. Fire Holder, fire Geithner, fire Bernanke. Get people in who will enforce the rule of law.
Professor Black, Lisa
and
Epstein.
And stop the foreclosures.
Listen.
Stop the foreclosures.
We look forward to having both of you back to the extent to which you're making it easier for everybody else in this country to understand the magnitude of this problem. I thank both of you, and I think that obviously the response as we deal with this and come to really understand the scope of the problem, people will understand why a very deliberative and real response to this, not a dismissive turn-the-page response, is what's in order for this problem. Bill Black, Lisa Epstein, thanks, guys. Coming up here on the Dylan Radigan Show.